Baldwood presents Evil at Alardyce House, written by Heather Atkinson and read by Sarah Barron. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Baldwood. Chapter 1. Alardyce House, Edinburgh, 1910. Amy sat on a bench close to the house, enjoying the fresh autumnal air, watching Henry stride across the grounds with the agility of a man considerably younger than his 50 years, having an eager discussion with the estate manager. Her husband never seemed to age, while she felt like an old lady. She looked down at her hands, the deformity now obvious even with her thick gloves on. Over the last couple of years, her arthritis had worsened, and they were ever more gnarled and almost constantly painful. Magda, the village healer, who everyone thought a witch, but Amy knew was just an exceedingly clever woman, had given her various tinctures that were increasingly ineffective, and despite her friend's best efforts, she'd been unable to come up with a more effective solution, so Amy had to accept that she was slowly losing the use of her hands. She'd been forced to give up her beloved embroidery and watercolours altogether. Thank goodness she could still hold a book, but that was about all she was fit for. She even walked like an old lady, thanks to the aches that had appeared in her hips. After her son Robert had left 12 years ago, she'd succumbed to another fever of grief. It hadn't been as severe as her previous fevers, but it had left her perpetually weakened. The cumulative effects of these illnesses, along with all the trauma her body had endured over the years, had prematurely aged her. Even her chestnut hair was fading. Lately, she'd started to worry that Henry would stop desiring her, but their relationship remained as intimate as ever. The vast majority of rich gentlemen had at least one mistress, but taking one was something he'd never done. He spent practically all of his time on the estate with her. It was no wonder she was feeling her age after everything she'd been through. Her life had fallen apart when she was just 17 years old and had been sent from London to live at Alardyce with her aunt and uncle on the death of her parents. She'd started an affair with Matthew Kroll, a very handsome footman, and fallen pregnant. When her vicious aunt had wanted to take her baby from her, she'd fled and toiled as a governess for years just so she could keep her oldest son Robert. After almost being killed by her insane cousin Edward, she discovered the boy she'd given up everything for was a monster just like Edward and his biological father. She'd survived several attacks, as well as the rejection of herself and Henry from society because of all the scandal. It could have been so much worse, and every day she counted her blessings. Henry spotted her and waved. Amy smiled and waved back, resting one hand on the walking stick she now needed to help her get around. She was too young to be so decrepit. She was only 46, but she supposed it was only natural after everything her body had been through. Life at Alardyce, Henry's ancestral home, was a lot quieter these days. Their youngest son Stephen was away at boarding school, where he was doing very well. John had left school and returned to the estate to learn how to run it. The world was changing, the old ways of the Victorian era falling away, and a lot more effort was required to keep Alardyce ticking over. As the eldest son, the estate would become John's on Henry's death, but the energetic 17-year-old wasn't showing much interest in his new lessons and preferred the company of his friends in the city. In a lot of ways, he was very like Robert, his older half-brother, but his friends were all respectable, although Amy knew that he did on occasion visit the local brothels. Fortunately, he had Henry's goodness, so she was reassured that he would never go down the dark path his older brother had taken. Their daughter Lydia was the belle of Edinburgh society and a renowned beauty with her long chestnut hair, just like her mother's, and her father's pale skin and dark eyes. She spent most of her leisure time at balls and soirees. As her parents wanted nothing to do with society, she often stayed with the Trentons, friends of Robert and his wife Jane. Jane had introduced them during one of her visits from London, and Nadia had taken to the girl immediately. As she only had sons, she longed for a daughter to introduce into society, And as Amy had no wish to do that herself, Nadia had thankfully taken on the burden for her. Nadia and Lydia were incredibly close, although nothing could interfere with the strong bond between Lydia and her mother. No one had heard from Robert since the terrible confrontation that had taken place at Alardyce House when he'd attacked his own mother and fought his stepfather. Amy had no proof he was still alive, but she felt strongly that he was. Certainly she would know if he had passed away. Part of her hoped she would see him again before she died, but she knew that if he ever did return, he'd bring carnage in his wake. He always did, and their family was so happy and content now. Robert had been forced to flee Edinburgh, not just because he was becoming a danger to those he loved, but Inspector Murphy, the darling of the Edinburgh Police Force, had been on his trail. Murphy had known Robert was responsible for not only the attacks on the women in the city, but at least two murders of men he'd considered to be his enemies, but he'd lacked any proof. Henry had used his influence to get the inspector to stop intermittently harassing their family. Fortunately, Murphy had ceased to be a threat when he'd retired 4 years ago. Amy's gaze drifted to the top of the crypt that was just visible through the trees. Henry had sealed it years ago, just like he'd promised, and no one else would be buried there. Their family had their very own sizeable plot in the village kirkyard, and it was a comfort to Amy to know that she wouldn't have to share a resting place with the man who'd almost destroyed her. Henry's younger brother Edward had been hanged for assaulting and murdering four women, although everyone thought his body count was much higher, as well as for attacking and almost killing Amy herself. He was the reason why her hands were in such a state now. Henry had his body secretly placed in the crypt. As he hadn't been married or even engaged to Amy back then, he'd seen nothing wrong with this, but he'd never found the right time to tell his wife. She'd only found out when Robert had blurted it out during that final, terrible confrontation with him 12 years ago. Knowing her son had only told her to try to drive a wedge between her and her husband, Amy had immediately forgiven Henry and refused to allow it to come between them. Amy shook herself out of these sad reminiscences of the past and smiled as she watched Henry say goodbye to the estate manager, then stride over to her.
"Any sign of John?" he asked, sitting on the bench beside her.
"No," she replied. "He stayed out all night."
"Again? That boy really needs to learn some responsibility."
"He's 17. I suppose it's only natural. At least he's not eloped to Gretna Green like Robert did at his age."
"There's a lot John hasn't done that Robert did at this age, so I suppose we should be grateful. I just wish he'd knuckle down and learn about the estate. He needs to take more of the burden onto his own shoulders. That would leave us more time to do things together."
"I was thinking we could take a trip to Riverwood, just the two of us," he said, covering her hand with his own, referring to the mansion they owned in the Lake District.
"Sounds lovely," she smiled. "But are you sure you want to go with a decrepit old woman like me?"
"I don't understand why you insist on calling yourself an old woman. You're as lovely as the day we met."
"Perhaps you should visit your doctor."
"Why?"
"There's obviously something wrong with your eyes."
"No, there isn't. You need to stop being so hard on yourself. And you certainly weren't an old woman in bed last night," he beamed, leaning in to kiss her.
"Yes, that was rather good," she smiled. "But I do feel like an old woman, and I'm losing the use of my hands. You still look so young and handsome. I'm afraid you'll find someone younger and more attractive." Gently, he took one of her hands in his own, mindful of how painful they were.
"I think the exact same thing about you. To me, you're no different to that scared girl who came to live here all those years ago. I feel like I'm the one who's slowing down, getting older."
"Henry, you just walked across the garden with the agility of someone in their 20s. Stephen would be hard-pressed to keep up with you. I'm the one with a walking stick."
"I've used a walking stick for years."
"You use a cane, not a walking stick, and it suits your brooding good looks."
"It does," he frowned.
"Yes, it's only an affectation. You don't need one to get about as I do."
"Amy Alardyce, I've loved you and only you my entire life, and I will never look at another. You're the only woman I want or will ever want. Even when we're in our 70s, you will always be the fiery, beautiful woman I fell in love with. Now stop all this nonsense.
Sorry, she said with a self-deprecating smile. I am sounding a bit sorry for myself.
Yes, you are. Now come on, he said, getting to his feet.
Where are we going? She replied, having to lean on her walking stick to get up off the bench.
To bed. To prove to you that you're not old.
I don't know. That idea is really ingrained in my mind now. I think it will take some time to persuade me otherwise. He smiled at the twinkle in her eye.
Get inside, you naughty girl, he said as they walked back to the house together, arm in arm. Oh, for God's sake, are you ever conscious anymore?
Amy sat up in bed with a frown, assuming Henry had spoken, but he was asleep beside her. Her attention was drawn to the chaise longue at the end of the bed, where Matthew was reclined on his side, propping himself up on one elbow.
Oh, it's you, she sighed. It's been a long time. 12 years, to be precise.
And it seems nothing's changed. Every time I visit, you're asleep.
It's not my fault if you choose to visit me in the middle of the night. Or have you been dead so long you've forgotten what it's like to be in a human body?
Never mind all that nonsense. Our boy's homesick.
Robert, she breathed, the name causing a pang in her heart. He's still alive, then?
You know he is, Amy.
I do. I would have felt it if our bond had been severed.
She frowned as she realised the meaning of his words. Do you mean he's thinking of coming back?
He's certainly pondering it. He misses you all. I can understand why he misses you, but as for the others...
He trailed off and grimaced.
Do not talk about my family like that.
Well, they're all dull, insipid lilies. None of them have your fire and passion.
I don't feel like that anymore. I'm an old woman now.
You have more life left in you than you think, and you're going to need it.
Robert's going to return, isn't he?
If he does, let's just say things will get pretty lively around here, which can't be a bad thing. This quiet life of yours is exceedingly dull.
No, it's not. I love my life. Just because I'm not imprisoning and killing people doesn't mean my life is boring, she sniffed.
His smile was fiendish.
I beg to differ.
Look, I'm very tired, so if that's all... He sat up with such speed it made her jump.
Oh, that's not it. I want to remind you that when you do eventually decide to throw off this dreary existence, I'll be waiting.
Yeah, so you keep saying,
she replied in a bored tone, even though inwardly she was unnerved.
Finally, it will be our time, and your pale fop won't get in the way, he added, nodding at Henry's sleeping form.
Something in his eyes changed. They widened slightly, one side of his mouth lifting into a malicious smile.
What is it? She frowned.
Nothing, he replied, looking back at her. But I will say one thing. You've got an eventful time coming up, my love.
You'd better get all the rest you can. What are you doing? She gasped, scrambling backwards up to the headboard when he climbed onto the end of the enormous bed and started crawling across it towards her on all fours.
I want you, Amy, he growled,
the shadows sliding across his face, distorting it, voice deepening.
Now!
You can't have me, she gasped. Henry! She cried,
but he didn't stir.
Your pale fop can't hear you.
He spat, his hand closing over her leg.
It's just you and me.
Her eyes widened with horror when she saw his fingers looked more like claws.
I'm coming for you, Amy, said Matthew, grip tightening on her leg. I'm coming.
Amy jumped awake with a cry, her breathing slowing when she realised she was safe in bed at home with her husband. She looked to the chaise longue, but Matthew wasn't there.
Thank God.
She breathed, running a hand across her sweat-soaked brow. Settling back into the pillows, she turned on her side to nestle into Henry, pulling the bedclothes up higher when she felt how cold his skin was. She did have a habit of hogging the covers and leaving him with none. Resting her head on his chest, she frowned when she didn't feel the steady rise and fall as he breathed. A sickening sense of wrongness gripped her, and she clung onto him tighter.
No, please, she whispered. No. When his arms failed to go around her, she forced herself to raise her head, a cry flying from her lips when she saw how blue his skin was. "No, no, no," she wailed. "Henry!" She prodded his arm, which would normally have been enough to wake him, but still he didn't stir. His expression was serene, as though he'd slipped away in his sleep. Her howl filled the room, bouncing off the oak-panelled walls, the sound full of horror and despair. She felt so numb that it took her a moment to realise the sound was coming from her. A tidal wave of grief slammed into her, and she gathered his lifeless body in her arms, gently rocking him, praying for his eyes to open. But they didn't. Now she knew why Matthew had smiled in that malevolent way. He'd seen what had happened. This realisation made her wail even louder. Her screams roused the rest of the house, and there was a hammering at the door, followed by demands to be let in. She could tell the voice belonged to Lydia, and Amy knew that she should go to her daughter and comfort her. But she was locked in a prison of her own grief, and she couldn't escape. Neither did she want to leave Henry's side for an instant. She never wanted to let go of him again. Lydia's voice was replaced by John's deep baritone, and the blows on the other side of the door started up again with renewed vigour. With a crack, the door gave way, and John stumbled inside along with Samuel the footman. Lydia entered behind them, along with Amy's maid Hazel and Forbes the butler, all in their nightclothes. Amy's cries had been so loud they'd reached the servants' bedrooms in the attic. "Oh, no," cried Lydia, a hand flying to her mouth. "Father!" Hazel wrapped a comforting arm around her while John approached his mother, gazing sadly down at his father, swallowing down his tears so he could help her.
"He's gone," he gently told her. "There's nothing you can do for him."
"No, he'll wake up, I know it," she said. The tears were pouring down her face unchecked and dripped onto Henry's cheek.
"He won't," he said, attempting to get her up off the bed. "Not even he could beat this."
"Yes, he can," she snarled, shoving his arm away. "Leave me with him."
"Mother, we can't.
Leave me,"
she yelled. "Shall I call the doctor, sir?" said Forbes. "He might be able to help."
"Call him and let him make all the arrangements," replied John, his sad gaze on his father's face. "But fetch Magda to tend to my mother."
"Yes, sir,"
he replied before leaving in his dressing gown.
"Leave us," John told the servants.
When they'd gone, Lydia and John sat on the bed either side of their mother, who still cradled her dead husband in her arms, refusing to let him go.
"I love you, father," breathed Lydia, pressing a kiss to his forehead.
"How did this happen?" said John, who was in a state of shock. He was the picture of health.
"The doctor will be able to tell us more," replied his sister.
At least it was peaceful.
"And mother was by his side," she said, looking at Amy, who continued her bizarre rocking.
She wasn't sure she could hear them, or was even aware of their presence. She seemed to be locked in her own world. Tears spilled down Lydia's face when her mother ran her twisted fingers through her husband's hair and down his face, as though she could wake him up. And when he didn't stir, she cried harder, a low, keening sound emanating from the back of her throat. Unable to bear it any more, Lydia leapt up, buried her face in her hands, and started to cry. John went to her and held her, allowing her to cry on his shoulder while looking down at his father, wishing he hadn't wasted the time they'd had together. He still had so much to learn. He wasn't ready to run Alardyce. Now he would be expected to steer the family through this fresh tragedy and see to the estate, and he was painfully aware that he was ill-equipped for the task. He'd give anything to have his father back. Magda burst into the room half an hour later, having been fetched from the village by the coachman, and John was more than happy to hand responsibility for the situation and his mother over to her. Magda was not only one of Amy's closest confidants, but she had saved her life more than once over the years. She flung off her white cloak, letting it drop to the floor, and strode to Amy's side. Amy finally looked up when she placed her hand on her arm.
"He's crossed over," Magda told her. "You need to let him go."
"I can't,"
Amy gasped between sobs.
"You have to, for your children's sake. They need you."
Magda's penetrating silver eyes and gentle but authoritative voice managed to break through the fog surrounding Amy, who nodded. Amy looked down at Henry and kissed his cold lips. "Goodbye, my love," she breathed before gently laying him back on the bed. Magda assisted her to her feet, and Amy stood looking down at Henry, shivering with shock. "I don't want to leave him," she said. "But you must. There are things that must be attended to." Amy nodded and looked to her children, feeling guilty for being so wrapped up in her own grief and ignoring theirs. She went to them, hugging first Lydia, then John. She took her son's face between her hands. His resemblance to his father had never been more pronounced. He'd inherited Henry's pale skin, tall, slender frame and dark eyes.
"Let's go downstairs," he said. "I think we could all use a brandy and a warm fire."
Magda wrapped Amy in her dressing gown, and the four of them left the room. Amy paused to look back at Henry, feeling her heart break in two. This was the worst pain she had ever experienced. Edward's torture had been nothing compared to this agony. Chapter 2. The fire had already been lit in the drawing room and the curtains drawn in every room of the house. They would remain closed until after the funeral. Everyone avoided the armchair Henry had favoured out of respect.
"I don't understand how it happened," repeated Lydia. "He was fine yesterday. I saw him striding about the estate as usual."
"Some ailments can strike suddenly," said Magda. "It could have been his heart or an aneurysm in the brain."
"Magda, please," said John, indicating Amy with a nod of his head. "Your mother has never shrunk from the truth in her entire life, and she's not going to start now."
Amy merely nodded and sipped her brandy, her gaze on the fire. She had to grip the glass with both hands because she was shaking so badly and because her hands were painful.
"We need to call Stephen home from school," Lydia told John.
"I'll arrange that in the morning," he replied. "Let him sleep for now."
"I'll telegram Aunt Esther and Aunt Lily."
Lydia bit her lip and looked down at the floor when she realised there was no one else to call. The infamous Alardyces had very few real friends. Their only other friends, Arthur Buchanan and his wife Mildred, had died years ago. Her parents had needed only each other. Now one half of that partnership was gone, and she feared her mother would be unable to cope. The last fever she'd suffered when Robert had left had weakened her considerably, and it was unlikely she would survive another.
"You can leave all the arrangements to me, Mother," said John. "I'll sort everything out, don't worry."
Finally, Amy raised her head, and the fire in her eyes heartened them all.
"I want to make the arrangements. It's the last thing I can do for him, and I won't let him down. You'll have enough in your hands with the estate. You're head of this family now, Sir John."
"I don't want it. I'm not ready."
"What you want is irrelevant, because it's already happened and you're more than capable. You just have to believe it yourself," she said, before returning to her quiet contemplation of the fire.
The doctor arrived and John led him upstairs. The steadfast Dr. Parlow, who had attended to Amy when she first fell pregnant with Robert, sighed at the sight of Henry's body.
"This is terrible. He was such a vital man. I thought he had years left in him."
"Which is what's puzzling us," replied John. "What could have caused this?"
"He did have a weakness of the heart. It could have given out while he was sleeping."
"Weakness of the heart?" he frowned.
"He didn't tell you."
John shook his head.
"He came to me with a disturbance of heart rhythm and some chest pain. I sent him to see a specialist in the city who said it could possibly be angina, but he wanted to conduct more tests. Your father had another appointment with him next week. Your mother knew nothing about it. Sir Henry didn't want to worry her."
"So you think the angina did this?" he said, nodding at his father's body.
"Angina in itself isn't life-threatening, but it could mean he was more at risk of a heart attack. He hadn't officially been diagnosed, but I'd say his heart problems could well be responsible for this."
"I think my mother needs to know for sure."
"You mean a post-mortem?"
"It's the only way to be certain."
You're aware of how invasive a procedure it is.
I am, and I hate the thought of it being done to him, but I know he'd approve if it gave my mother some peace.
I am happy to fill out the death certificate right now with myocardial infarction as the cause of death, but I can arrange a post-mortem if you'd prefer.
John looked down at his father's body and swallowed hard.
I need to discuss it with the family. All right, but I recommend you don't leave it long. Shall I arrange for the body to be taken away, or do you want to do everything here?
I don't know, John said, feeling completely lost and useless. His father had been the most capable man he'd ever known. He would have known the answers to all these questions.
I'll go and ask them now.
He hurried out of the room, feeling he'd disgraced himself in front of his father's body. He wasn't ready for all this responsibility. He had no idea what he was doing, and his mother was in no fit state to guide him. He returned to the drawing room to find Lydia standing at the window openly weeping, while their mother stared catatonically into the flames. Magda sipped a cup of tea, serene as always. He cleared his throat.
Dr. Parlow wants to know if you want him to arrange to have father taken away or...
No, snapped Amy. No one's taking him away. He'll stay here until the funeral. It's his home. I'll wash and dress him myself.
I'll help you, said Magda. Thank you. Do you want me to stay for a few days? Added Magda.
Yes, please, if you don't mind.
I don't mind at all.
Amy's smile was sad, eyes shining with gratitude. John was relieved Magda would be staying with them. She was excellent in a crisis and would be able to handle his mother.
Dr. Parlow told me something else, he said slowly, not sure whether he should say this now, but they had to decide about the post-mortem. Father had an irregular heartbeat and he was experiencing chest pains.
What? Rasped Amy, eyes filling with fresh tears.
He didn't want to worry you, so he was keeping it quiet until he found out what was going on. Parlow sent him to see a specialist who thought it might be angina, but before he could have the test done, he... You know...
Amy stared back at him in bewilderment.
But I watched him walking yesterday. He looked so fit and strong. He wasn't clutching at his chest. I never once saw him in pain.
She got to her feet.
I'm going to speak to Parlow, and I want to talk to the specialist too, she said, striding for the door. Why don't you let me do that? Began John, but she walked past him and out the door.
Let her do what she needs to do, said Lydia, dabbing at her eyes with a handkerchief. You won't be able to stop her.
What do I do, Lydia? He said. I've no idea. I feel so useless.
Just grieve for father. Everything else can wait.
It was what he needed to hear, and the two siblings clung onto each other, crying. Magda slipped out of the room to give them some privacy.
You, said Amy, striding into the bedroom where Dr. Parlow waited. She came to a halt at the sight of Henry's body, the grief hitting her all over again. How can I help, Amy? He said gently.
She tore her eyes off Henry and onto him.
What's this nonsense about a heart problem? There was nothing wrong with him. I'm afraid to say there was an issue. What it was, I can't say. I want to speak to this specialist. Of course, I'll leave you his address. Dr. Bassett is an excellent doctor. He'll be happy to answer your questions.
So you think it's likely this condition killed Henry?
I couldn't say for sure. Did John mention the post-mortem?
Her eyes widened with horror.
Post-mortem?
He thought you might want to know for certain how he died.
You're asking me if I want you to cut my husband open, take out his insides and prod and poke around inside him.
I understand it's an extremely delicate matter, but no one is cutting him open, she yelled. It's disgusting that you've even considered it, and I will be having words with John too. Henry died peacefully. No one came in and attacked him, so we know it was natural causes. I won't let you desecrate his body.
He held up his hands.
Of course, I understand. If you want, I'll put heart attack as cause of death on the death certificate.
Thank you. Now, if you'll excuse me, I want to be alone with him.
Do you need me to arrange for his body to be collected?
No, he's staying here.
Parlo nodded. May I say how very sorry I am? He was a great man.
Amy acknowledged this with a nod of the head.
Without another word, Parlo left. When he'd gone, Amy sank onto the bed beside Henry and wept.
Go away, she called when there was a knock at the door.
As you wish, replied Magda's voice.
No, wait. Please come in.
Magda walked in and quietly closed the door behind her. She stood at the end of the bed, looking down at Henry.
Was this natural, like Parlo thinks? Amy asked her. Do you feel anything bad happened?
No. He slipped away in his sleep. Just so you know, he felt no pain.
That's a relief.
She knew Magda well enough to believe she was speaking the truth. She wasn't one for giving hollow words of comfort.
Could... Amy paused, unable to believe she was about to say this. Could Matthew have done this?
Matthew? Just before I woke up and found Henry like this, I dreamed he was in the room, sitting there, she added, pointing to the chaise longue. If he was capable, he would have done it years ago. Henry was pure and strong. Matthew couldn't touch him.
Amy exhaled with relief.
That makes me feel so much better. So, do you think it was his heart?
I can't say, but I think it's very probable.
Parlo suggested cutting him open to find out for certain. I told him no.
Good for you.
Amy's eyes filled with hope.
Can you sense Henry? Is he still here?
He will always be near you. Never doubt that.
Amy looked down at him and ran her fingers through his hair, which felt just as it had when he was alive.
I always thought I would be the one to go first. I can't believe this has happened.
She sighed and shook her head.
I've given Lydia and John no comfort. They're my children, and I've abandoned them to their grief.
They'll cope. They're adults now. You don't need to shelter them from the trials of life anymore, so grieve for your husband. I can't even begin to imagine how you're feeling right now.
Magda could feel the agony washing off Amy. Sometimes being an empath was an absolute curse. She didn't want to feel this pain, but she wouldn't let her friend down.
Is there anything I can do to help?
Amy's head snapped up as an idea occurred to her.
You can contact the dead. I've seen you do it. Can you contact Henry?
I recommend giving it a few days. He's just crossed over. We could perhaps try after the funeral.
Amy sighed with disappointment and nodded. If you think that's best.
I do. I wish I'd gone first. I can't bear this pain.
She took one of Henry's hands in her own and kissed it.
Why did you have to go now? She told him. We could have had many more years together.
I'll leave you in peace, said Magda, quietly retreating,
unable to bear the pain any more, her heart breaking for Amy. She returned to the drawing room.
Magda, said Lydia the moment she walked in, I'm worried about Mother. This could bring on another fever, only if it does, I fear she won't fight it.
And I'm afraid you're right, Magda replied. My remedies only work if the patient wants to live. If they don't, then they're only as useful as Parlo's quackery.
We can't lose her too, said Lydia, starting to cry again.
John wrapped an arm around her.
We won't. If our mother's anything, she's a fighter.
Father was her world. Besides Magda, she had no one else. We were so caught up in our own lives with parties and friends and society. We must be more available for her, stay on the estate more, keep her interested in the world.
She won't want you putting your lives on hold for her, said Magda.
We won't. We're Alardyces and we support each other in times of trouble.
Magda nodded with approval. Chapter 3. Robert wiped the sweat from his brow and glared up at the sun. He'd never got used to it, and he missed the cold, damp Scottish climate. After one terrible case of sunburn that had him laid up for days, Robert had quickly learned to always keep his skin covered, wear a hat, and drink plenty of water. He never wanted to feel that bad again. After leaving Edinburgh 12 years ago, Robert had taken a steamer for Argentina, stopping off at several different places on the way, all of which he could barely remember, as he'd been depressed, bereft after abandoning his family. Not that he'd wanted to leave them behind. His darker self had been gaining too much control over him, leaving him no choice but to flee to avoid hurting those he loved. Even now, so many years later, the memory of his hands wrapped around his own mother's neck, squeezing hard, the pain in her eyes, was like a knife in his chest. His mother was one of the people he'd loved most in the world. After she'd fled Alardyce House when she was still a girl, just so she could keep him and not be forced to give him up to strangers, it had just been the two of them. Although she'd worked as a governess for some very pleasant people who had been happy for her to have her son tagging along, none of them had sought her company, so they'd only had each other. Now he was a grown man, he could imagine that must have been very lonely for her. Then she'd married Henry after almost being murdered by his mad brother Edward, and she'd never been lonely again. Robert had to admit that a lot of the hatred that had driven him that terrible day had been caused by jealousy. He'd resented how close she was with her husband, and although he loved his siblings, he'd had to share her with them, and that had been turning him bitter and driving his darker half, the one that had wanted to hurt women. The only good thing was that his depression and lethargy effectively muted the part of him that thrived on violence and other people's pain. When the steamer had arrived in Argentina, its final destination, he'd taken a suite at the luxurious Bristol Hotel in Mar del Plata, a city on the east coast. The decadence of the hotel, its lovely mock Tudor style, wealthy guests and stunning sea view, did nothing to lift his spirits, and he spent the first 3 weeks hiding away in his suite, shunning the company of everyone but the servant who brought him his meals. Not even the pretty little maids could raise his interest. He spent hours poring over photographs and letters, torturing himself with thoughts of those he loved, wondering if they all hated him or were worried for him. So many times he was tempted to go back, but he knew he had to stand firm. Not only did the police have him in their sights, especially that damned Inspector Murphy, but he was also afraid of hurting his family again. Every time he felt himself weakening, he recalled Magda's words. She had told him fleeing was the only way to protect them. So he'd forced himself to stay in this strange place where he had no one. However, 3 weeks into his self-imposed exile, Robert had become bored. If he was going to survive, he needed something to occupy his time. The hotel ordered the British papers, so he still had access to all the news. Due to the time it took for the papers to arrive, the news was old by the time he read it, but it was better than not knowing at all. Every day he would anxiously scan the newspapers, looking for advertisements from the Edinburgh police asking for information about him, but there was no mention of him or any other Alardyces for that matter. No doubt Henry had done his usual efficient job of covering everything up. He was good at that. Bitterness filled his heart whenever he thought of the stepfather he'd once loved, although after fighting Henry and almost losing, his respect for him had increased. When it became clear there were no international agencies searching for him, Robert began to relax a little and his business mind started to take over. It was an article written about the Selknam genocide that had occurred in Tierra del Fuego, a province at the southern tip of South America, half of which was owned by Argentina, the other half by Chile, that really got him thinking. The Selknam were a semi-nomadic tribe whose numbers had been reduced from 4,000 to 500 in the space of 15 years due to a campaign of extermination instigated by European settlers and supported by both the Argentine and Chilean governments. The tragedy of the story wasn't what caught Robert's interest. It was the mention of a man named Popper, a mining engineer who was involved in the abduction of a lot of these Indian women who were then placed in brothels to be used and abused by men. This sparked an interest in mines in Robert, and from then on he scoured all the newspapers for any mention of them. He even started learning Spanish so he could read the local papers too. The familiar fire he'd had when studying business back in Edinburgh once more filled his veins and returned to him his interest in living. He would get into mining and swell his fortune. He had access to more than enough money to invest. Robert had recalled Henry telling him he was considering investing in a South African diamond mine. Was that the place to go, or should he stay in Argentina? He would have to do his research. This decision led to a most enjoyable few months, during which he got to know some of the wealthy and connected patrons of the Bristol Hotel. He lavished drinks upon them, making them loose-lipped, so they gave him privileged information about the best investments. He heard about gold rushes in Canada, silver mining in North America, copper mining in China and the Congo. Lots of exotic, tantalising countries just waiting for him to explore, as well as exploit. But Robert found diamond mining held the biggest interest for him. Russia, Canada and Botswana were the biggest producers, but he found the prospect of South Africa the most intriguing. Perhaps it was because he knew Henry was considering investing and he wanted to get there before he did. What also spurred Robert's interest was the fact that diamonds had just been discovered on farms near Pretoria. South Africa was also rich in gold deposits, and gold was desperately needed to support the blossoming flow of international trade. The only problem was a larger corporation had bought up all the smaller South African mines, which would make it very difficult for him to get a foothold. However, it looked like the country was about to erupt into a second violent conflict after the Boer War ended in 1881. This fresh war was fuelled by the discovery of gold in the Witwatersrand Basin in northeastern South Africa back in 1886, which had drawn in a lot of British migrant workers, as well as the fact that Britain refused to withdraw all its troops from the country's borders. Trouble was definitely brewing, and all signs indicated that a second war was about to break out. Robert's love of adventure urged him to go there, because where there was danger, people were distracted. But he doubted any more British migrants would be welcome, and he certainly had no wish to end up dead, nor to get caught up in a war. So he decided to set his sights on somewhere else. But where? 2 months after his arrival in Argentina, Robert met a pale, wilting lily of a man called Peter Anderson, who hailed from Perth. Peter arrived at the Bristol Hotel, his cheeks already kissed with sunburn, his delicate complexion totally unsuited to the heat. Hearing from other guests that Robert was a fellow Scot, Peter immediately sought him out, and the two men bonded over a few drinks on the terrace, looking out at the sea while discussing home. It was clear Peter was incredibly homesick. However, one thing he was very tight-lipped about was his reason for being in Argentina. No amount of scotch or nostalgia could get it out of him. Robert scented a secret, and he set on ferreting it out. One night, Robert got Peter so maudlin about Scotland that he almost drank the bar dry of scotch. So drunk was he, Robert had to assist him back to his room. The moment he was unceremoniously dumped on the bed, Peter lost consciousness, leaving Robert free to go through his papers. It soon became clear why his friend had refused to tell him anything. Peter's family owned 3 mines in Kimberley, South Africa. They were locked in a fierce rivalry with an English family who hailed from London. Both families had made enormous fortunes from the South African diamond mines, but their success had been embittered by their feud, fuelled by their mutual desire to control the Kimberley Diamond Mining Company. Peter had travelled to Argentina to meet with members of his family to request permission to write out a cheque for an enormous sum to buy the controlling shares. His uncle was head of the family and was usually based in South Africa, but he'd come to Argentina on some business and Peter had hastened to follow him from Kimberley when he'd heard the shares would soon be available to buy. Robert's lips curled into a smile. He was in a position to more than match that sum of money. It would be a huge risk. It might well eat up all his capital and he could be left with nothing. But if he pulled it off, he would be the major shareholder in one of the most profitable diamond mining companies in the world. But would waltzing in with a huge cheque be enough? He had no experience of or knowledge of diamond mining. Could this go in his favour? Robert was confident his extremely sharp mind would pick it all up very quickly. From what he'd heard, it was undoubtedly a cutthroat business, but that was where he thrived. This rival would see him as a wet-behind-the-ears boy with a large amount of money. He would think Christmas had come early, but Robert would soon turn the tables. Excitement coursed through him as he studied the documents while Peter continued to sleep on, memorising names, addresses, dates and figures. He even made a few notes. Once he was finished, He carefully replaced the papers exactly as he'd found them before rushing back to his room to pack. He then told the hotel receptionist that he had to return home on urgent family business in case Peter asked about him. Robert managed to catch the last train from Mar del Plata to Buenos Aires. He went straight to the very busy port and made inquiries about how he could travel to South Africa as quickly as possible. His luck was in, and he found a rather splendid merchant ship to take him there, which would be leaving the following morning. There was a lot of trade between South Africa and Argentina, which had really expanded during the Boer War, so there were always ships back and forth between the two countries. This confirmed to Robert that Providence was on his side. Back in Scotland, he'd promised himself he would take the first ship he could get passage on, which had been destined to come here, where he'd met Peter Anderson, which was now leading him to South Africa, to where he was easily able to get another ship. Everything was working out so perfectly, it seemed this was all fated for him. Once his passage was settled and his trunk safely stowed on board, doubt began to set in. Thousands of miles would separate him from his loved ones. When he'd arrived here, he hadn't had a plan. Argentina had merely been a stopgap for him to gather his thoughts, and the possibility of returning to Alardyce had always been at the back of his mind, despite the danger. But this plan of his to go to South Africa was much more permanent. All of his capital would be tied up in this new venture, meaning he would be committed to an entirely new life. He would be unable to return for years. He might never even get the chance to return if it all went wrong and he died out there penniless and alone, his family never knowing what became of him. Robert headed into a rather rough little tavern to sit and think while nursing a rum. Images of Jane, his little daughter Emily, and his mother swirled through his head, as well as his young siblings. Could he leave them behind once and for all? He was almost tempted to return to Scotland, until he recalled Jane lying unconscious on the floor after he'd struck her and his hands wrapped around his own mother's throat. "No," he grunted. For the first time in years, he was going to put others first. He had to leave. He would go to South Africa and make a huge fortune in the diamond mines, and maybe one day he'd be able to return a prosperous man, someone his family could be proud of. Hopefully, while he was out there, he'd also be able to gain control over his dark thoughts. They were remaining dormant in the wake of the enormous life changes he was going through, as though equally stunned by it all as himself. But one day they would return, and he had to be ready. Robert was determined not to turn into his biological father or uncle. It was an anxious wait for him to depart Argentina, constantly expecting Peter to work out what he'd done and catch up with him, but he boarded the ship the following day without incident. The journey of nearly 5,000 miles was long and arduous. The experienced and determined captain managed to get 6 knots a day out of the ship, which was a fine vessel that the crew took pride in. The voyage took 28 days in total, and while some of the other passengers suffered seasickness, the journey invigorated Robert, especially around the Cape of Good Hope. He threw himself into helping the crew, revelling in the crackle of lightning overhead and the boom of thunder as he was drenched in ice-cold water, the ship tilting up towards the sky before plunging back down bow first, sending more water crashing over the deck. Robert's heart raced and his body filled with adrenaline. The excitement was such that it rivaled the thrill he got when he attacked a woman. He fought with the rest of the men to keep the ship on its course, and after they rounded the cape and the storm died away to a gentle breeze, the black clouds clearing to reveal the sun, he tilted his face to the blue sky and inhaled the air, dragging it deep into his lungs to calm the frantic beat of his heart. In that moment, he wondered if he'd attacked those women simply for the thrill of it all. It hadn't just been the need to hurt a woman that had driven him, although he had got a lot of pleasure from their screams. It had also been the excitement of getting away with a crime and of eluding the police, especially that bastard Murphy. It had made him feel infinitely superior, as had fighting the elements today and winning. After this, Robert became very friendly with the crew. The captain clapped him on the back and invited him to join his crew. Robert had been sorely tempted. That life would certainly give him all the adventure he was craving. He would get to travel the world, see new and exotic places, but he wouldn't get to pit his business wits against others, and he would have to take orders, something he'd never been any good at. So Robert had thanked the captain for his kind offer, but turned it down with a friendly handshake. During the voyage, Robert had learnt from the crew that Cape Town Harbour had become too small for all the ships that now regularly crowded into it. Many of these were British ships full of people hungry to exploit the diamond rush. This influx had made up for the loss of shipping the harbour had suffered when the Suez Canal had been opened in 1869, steamers travelling from Europe to Australia and Asia preferring this new route. Thanks to diamond fever, a massive seaward extension was being added to the harbour. Robert walked by a large steamer called RMS Moore, indicating it was a Royal Mail ship carrying mail. To confirm this, it flew the Royal Mail pennant. These ships were popular choices for travellers because, as they carried mail, they were contracted to be on time and would be fined heavily if late. Robert watched as two young women in their early 20s, accompanied by two small boys, disembarked from this ship. The women were both very attractive, with dark blonde hair held back under their bonnets. They spoke with Cornish accents, the two women excitedly chattering and pointing out various sights, while the little boys walked between them, eyes wide with wonder, the smallest of the boys jumping at the sound of the wheels of the train that chugged around the harbour, clattering close by.
"Keep hold of my hand, George," chided one of the women. "We don't want to lose you here."
Despite the vibrancy and exotic strangeness of the surroundings, Robert found himself homing in on these two women, particularly the one who looked slightly younger and held the hand of the rambunctious George. He followed them as they weaved in and out of the horses, pulling carts, disembarking passengers and dock workers, passing the leviathan hulks of the steamships that had docked. The little boys stared at the native people with undisguised wonder, never having seen anyone black before. Robert ignored it all as the blood thundered in his head, gaze locked on the young woman in the pretty yellow silks.
"George, don't lag," urged the woman,
pulling the boy on when he stopped to point and smile at a particularly lovely grey horse that trudged past pulling a cart. The older girl looked back over her shoulder at her companion while maintaining a firm grip on the hand of the older boy.
"Come on, Janie," she called to her. "Michael will be waiting." "I can't help it," retorted Janie. "George keeps wanting to stop and look at everything."
"George," snapped the older woman, "keep up with Auntie Janie."
Robert smiled to himself. So these two were sisters, and the boys were the older sister's spawn. He surmised Michael was the boy's father and husband of the elder sister. As they passed the hulk of the RMS Norman, which cast a shadow over them all, blotting out the hot South African sun, Janie happened to glance back over her shoulder and caught Robert staring at her. When she saw a handsome young man looking her way, Janie smiled back at him. She looked back round and came to a halt when she realised her older sister had been swallowed up by the crowd of passengers disembarking from the Norman.
"Lily," she called. "Lily."
The little boy, his senses already overwhelmed, began to cry.
"Mama,"
he wailed.
"Don't worry, George,"
Janie told him, smiling down at him benevolently.
"I know exactly where they're going, so we'll easily find them. In the meantime, you count and tell me how many horses we see. You're so clever at counting."
The trick worked, and the little boy beamed and began looking around, jabbing a finger at a light brown horse and frantically babbling. This left Janie free to try to spot her sister in the heaving mass.
"May I be of some assistance?" said Robert, coming up beside her.
"Oh, hello,"
she replied, forcing a polite smile, despite the fact that she appeared to be overwhelmed by her surroundings.
"I seem to have lost my sister. That's what I get for lagging behind," she added with a self-deprecating smile.
"I'm sure we'll be able to find her. She can't have gone on too far ahead in this throng."
"Yes, of course, you're right."
The fact that he was also British and that he was obviously well-mannered and dressed in expensive clothes went a long way to reassuring her.
"I'm very indebted to you, Mr.
Bruce," he replied.
Robert didn't know what had urged him to give the name of a man he had killed, but he decided to go along with it. His instinct hadn't let him down yet.
Mr. Bruce, smiled Janey. I'm Miss Eddie, and this young man is my nephew, George.
It's an honour to meet you both, smiled back Robert, giving George a bow that made him grin. Thanks to his younger sister.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.